you can have all of the most perfect answers in the world and still not get hired. So if that's the case, what is it? This is about making a personal connection with the interviewers. Mm. And that is something that a lot of people don't focus on. So in the book and in the online course, I get into a lot of what are all the different things that you can do to make a personal connection with somebody, from researching them before you even get to the interview, so that when you first meet them, you can connect with them and say, hey, let me tell you what I know about you, which the person will go, gosh, that's kind of cool. Yep. That you even took the time to do that, calling the person by name. I mean, there's a lot of those types of things. But, you know, in terms of people interviewing and what has changed, it used to be an extremely formal process, and it was one-on-one, and it was, for the most part, unstructured. You got there, and they didn't tell you what the questions were going to be. And if the interviewer was interviewing three or four people in a day, they may ask each of those people different questions.
Right.
And so it was so subjective that people really got upset about that and said, wait a second, if I happen to talk to the person who went before me, you got different questions than I got, and mm-hmm. my questions were harder. That wasn't fair. So then they went to standardizing things, where now they ask the same questions of every single candidate. Not only is it one interviewer, now you've got panels. I've seen panels up to 14 people.
Wow.
And so when I talk in
no
the
pressure,
can you imagine? When I talk to people about, you really got to find out what environment you're walking into before you get there. If you go in expecting one or two people and you walk into a room of 14 people, you're liable to be thrown and not ever recover before the interview is over.
Right.
So there's lots of those types of things that have changed. And again, the process is way more lengthy now. And I expect it to even be longer now, coming out of the pandemic, because let's face it, we're in a buyer's world right yep. now. We've got millions of people out of work, and going into an interview, doing a good job historically may have been good enough for you to get a job. Now that the competition is so great, because there's so many people competing for the same jobs, I think whatever level people have been interviewing at, they've got to up that, because let's face it, where you might have had two or three different candidates to compete against that were great, now you've got 25.
Right. So. That's so interesting you say not crafting your answer as well, because I feel like, we'll say this a lot in marketing, of we're just smarter consumers. I feel like we're smarter leaders. I know if I go click on a site, you're going to track me, right? I know because you have my information, you're going to follow me around. I know as a leader on the other seat of the interview table, being the interviewer, I know when you've crafted and practiced an answer. I know that that is the answer that you think I want to hear.
Right, right. And so it's a matter of how do you, I always tell people, here's your standard answer. Now, how are you going to tweak that or modify that to make it novel, to also make it part of you, so that it's not seen by the interviewer as, well, that's an answer that you could probably get online,
right.
You know, in 55 yes. different places.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And so one of the things I tell people is to use questions to add commentary. So I've got my answer to your question, but before I give you the answer to your question, is there anything that I want to say to you, and use that time to set the answer up that tells you even more than you expected to hear. Mm-hmm. So there's lots mm-hmm. of ways to do that, but unfortunately, a lot of people are locked into going online and saying, how do I answer this question? They script it, and then that's what they deliver. And they're missing the fact that the interviewer is doing what you just said. It's like, that's the same answer that five people gave.
Right, right. So given that, Craig, what are some ways that we can stand out if we are looking for a job, given the fact that now we have 25 to compete with instead of two? What are those little things that we can do to make sure that we are remembered? Because I feel like that's another thing too that leaders struggle with. And you mentioned it, as you know, you go through the phone process and then perhaps you're on Zoom. And I feel like every day's kind of run into the next, every Zoom has run into the next. So what are some ways that we can stand out? And then, you know, as a leader, I can jog my memory and go, he or she stood out to me because they did this?
Interestingly enough, some of the very small things that people can do, most people don't do. Even thank you notes. I always tell people, and this is after, I'm going to come back to the beginning of the interview, but even after the interview, yeah, if you don't have a thank you note, a handwritten note that you can deliver in their inbox or through their mail system or put it on their desk before you leave, you're making a mistake. Most people will shoot an email, and what I always suggest is the easier that it is for you to do, the less valued it's going to be by the person receiving it.
That's good, yeah.
And so on the front end, I want to find out about my interviewer or interviewers. And a lot of people will say, you know, find out about their background. That's about all they say. I go further and say, not only do you need to find out about it, you need to convey to the interviewer that you know those things about them, and you want to look for commonalities that you have with them. Why is that the case? And this goes back to my psychology background. We tend to like people more who we have things in common with. So you're going to find in my book a lot of things that capitalize on just human nature. If you like people who you have things in common with, well, then I got to let you know, hey, we have this in common. But I can't say, hey, Whitney, what I know about you is sometimes when Isaac is in the house doing whatever, you go out on the balcony and you read and you go, he must have listened to my podcast.
That's great. You were prepared for this interview, Craig.
What does that have to do with me interviewing for this job? It's got nothing to do. So now not only do I have to, and I call those commonalities, research your interviewer, find things you have in common. Now you want to share those in the interview, but you've got to make it relevant to the job. And so now I can say, the way that you and I are alike, and I wouldn't necessarily say that in the interview, is that every now and then we need to step away. When you're a small business owner, you need to set guidelines and set limits. I'm not going to do work during these hours. And I know that one way both of us do that is we both read and we take time out and we relax in that time and space. So now I'm sharing with you something we have in common. Now you're going to like me a little bit more because we have something in common, and I have made it relevant to how I will be a better employee.
Nice.
And that's what, you know, those types of things.
Yeah,